I'd like to bring up Jade Vinson, who is a dear friend, but also a museum trustee. On the side, a jewelry designer. If you've loved and admired the Pythagorean earrings up in the shop, this is the guy to thank. And he's recently retired from Renaissance Technologies. Jade.
Thank you, Cindy. So I'm Jade Vinson, one of the trustees of the museum, and it is my great pleasure to introduce Ingrid Daubechies from Duke University. I had the pleasure of meeting Ingrid Daubechies many years ago as a first-year graduate student at Princeton. She was my first-year graduate student advisor and steered me in a good direction. Ingrid Daubechies is, at the time, was a hotshot young faculty at Duke who proved some of the pivotal results in using wavelets for image compression and signals analysis, and has since done a lot of leadership in the mathematical community at both the American Mathematical Society and the IMU, International Mathematicians Union. And her recent work is on applying these mathematical techniques of wavelets and signal analysis to the study of art. Will you please join me in welcoming Ingrid Daubechies?
Well, thanks so much. It's a pleasure to be here, and I hope you will enjoy hearing about math as an art detective. So what we will be talking about is, we'll talk a little bit about mathematical tools for image analysis, and that's where we'll have our workshop activity. What you will need for that is the number that is on your seat. I mean, on your seat on the back or on the seat of your seat, there was a post-it. That number is has a red and a blue number on it, a label on it. So you will need those. If I see there might be a few people who don't have theirs, they probably can reconstitute it easily from what their neighbors is and so on. And also it will be explained how the numbers are. Then we'll see how these tools are used on digital images of paintings. And we'll get on to the mysteries that you were promised in the title. So, working with digital images. In fact, what digital image processing does is it computes with digital images. And how can I do that? Well, images consist of pixels. And if I think of it as a grayscale image, then we have that every one of these small pixels, a small square, has a gray level that can go from all black in an 8-bit image labeled by 0 to all white, labeled by 255, so that you have 256 different numbers. And I like to joke that that means that mathematicians, digital image processors, instead of only 50 shades of gray, have 254 of them. I mean, so once you have the pixels, the gray value of these pixels have numbers, you can compute with them. You can compute averages of them. You can compute differences and so on. And all the tools that you use in digital image processing use those computations. Everything you might do in Photoshop with images actually is computing things with those numbers. When you have a color image, you have RGB, and you have that scale in from 0 to 255 in R, G, and B, and that makes your color images. Okay. So how does this work? Well, let's take this digitized version of a self-portrait by Van Gogh. And if I blow up a little piece of it and blow it up enough that you start seeing the individual pixels, then I can actually, for this very tiny little piece of that painting, take out that bottom row. And the pixels, these are the actual pixels corresponding to that row, are, and I've printed in bold the ones that are lower than 100 to remind us that these are darker pixels. So I have all these numbers, 72, 75, and so on, going on for that little piece. And on these numbers, this is just a little piece of it, and I repeat it here, we already see one feature that is going to be important for our way of doing image processing, namely that for many of these pixels, the neighbors have very, very similar values. You have jumps, I mean, and in fact, we do have a jump here from lighter to darker, and that is corresponding to a jump in the numbers. But those jumps could happen anywhere. They, for a particular image, they happen in only special places, and rarely over the whole image. But for a different image, they could happen in different places. And so what you want is something that exploits the properties of images that many pixels have very the same values or similar values to their neighbors without trying to pin down exactly where it is, because it could happen anywhere. So one way of exploiting the fact that neighboring pixels have similar values is by grouping the pixels in pairs, and then for each pair, computing their average. And even for this, we still have very similar values, so we could do it again. We could take pairs and compute their averages. Now, when replacing two numbers by one number, you obviously have lost information. If you just have the average of the two numbers, what you've lost is how much each of those numbers differs from the average. So that is information that's given by the difference between the two numbers. And again here, going from this black row to that black row, I lost the information that is the difference between those two numbers. And you see sometimes that difference is positive, because sometimes the second number is bigger than the first, but sometimes it's negative, because the second number is smaller than the first. So the differences could be positive or negative. When you have two numbers and you know their average as well as their difference, you can reconstruct the two numbers. So this information, these two red rows together with that black row, these two are sufficient to get that black row back, and these two back to this. So these two red rows plus the last black row have all the information to go back. But many, we have gained in that many of these red numbers are very small. So, however, many of them are small, but occasionally some of them are large. When are they large? Well, when the average deviates quite a bit from its two parents. And that means something was happening in the picture. So the large numbers tell you where these jumps are going to occur. Okay, now that was just 1D. An image really is two-dimensional. So we'll make a two-dimensional transform right here in the room. You all will be pixels. The picture that we will analyze is this picture. And the numbers that you have tell you which pixel that you are. So you have a row number. The red number tells you on which row, the first row, second row, and so on, you are. And the column number tells you on your row what seat you are. And this has those numbers. So with your red number and your blue number, you can, on the screen, see what type of pixel you are. Are you a very dark pixel? Are you a grayer pixel? Are you a light pixel? So everybody understand? Please find out what your pixel is. Dark, gray. No 50 shades of gray here, okay. We'll give them numbers. If you're dark, you're 40. If you're medium, you're 80. If you were the lightest gray, you're 120. So everybody of you should now know their value. So you're a little memory cell, little pixel memory cell with one value in it. And we're now, who has a number larger than 10? Everybody. So I need all these memory cells in order to, let's say that numbers smaller than 10 can be neglected. I can't neglect any of you. What you're now going to do is we're going to take a two-dimensional wavelet transform. The first thing is that you work within your row. And what happens is that if you have a seat, if you have for n some integer, you're either in this case or that case. You find your neighbor of the, I mean, if you're 5, then you find your neighbor 6. You're 5 and 6. And you confer with each other, and you compute for the two numbers that you have, the average and the difference. Please do that. No, they're 5, so 6, so this is 7 and you're 8. So you should talk to each other. Yes. 2n and 2n minus 1. No, but because I need, yeah, missing. Okay, everybody. So, the new numbers you found, you have to remember. Who remembers what? Well, the even, the one who started with an even seat number, an even blue number, remembers the average. The one who had the odd number should remember the difference. Okay? So write them down if you want to make sure. That was in one direction. Next, we're going to work between rows. So you will have to work with the person behind or in front of you. Which one depends on whether your row number was even or odd, so the red number on your post-it note. So you now take the number that they have in memory, not the original pixel value. Each of you has a number in memory. You take your two numbers in memory and you compute their average or their difference.
Just keep saying 40. I keep saying we're supposed to look at the actual.
Yeah, no, but you had 40 and you were black as well?
Yeah.
Okay, so you both had 40. So their average was 40. That was what you keep, and the difference is 0.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Okay, and you had 40 as well?
Yes.
So now you compute your average.
It's 40.
And you keep that in my memory. And the difference between those two is 0, and you keep that. Okay. You did the ones, yeah. Okay, your red number was the row index. Okay, so let's go back to the picture. So the red numbers towards the back. The blue numbered this way. So this is kind of, this is the front here. This is where I'm standing here around 7 at 0. So we go 1 and so on. We're missing a couple of columns there. That's why you start with 5. You go across like that in blue, and then towards the back in red. Okay? So everybody has done this computation? So we first did the first computation. You kept new members in memory. And then you use those to do the second computation. Okay?
So can I just ask,
yes.
Are we using the value that you just gave us for our...
The pixel value was what you computed with in the first round.
Okay.
In the second round, you compute with the numbers you computed in the first round.
Okay.
So in the first round, some of you had to keep in memory the average. Some of you had to keep in memory the difference. So those were the inputs that you're using now. Okay. I'd like to see hands of everybody who, after this computation, has a number bigger than 10. After the computation, the second computation, you've averaged once this way and differenced, and then you've averaged and differenced that way. Some of you have in memory averages of two numbers, twice averaged. And then others have something that has at least one type of differencing in it. Okay? So raise your hand if you had now, after all the computations in memory, something that's bigger than 10. So please, please raise, because we need to see. Now, if you look around, you'll see that there are big areas where there's nothing much happening. Much fewer numbers are important. And in fact, if I, okay, so now I'm going to ask another thing, hands down. If you are on an even row number, so if both your red numbers and your blue numbers are even, please don't raise your hand, no matter what your memory is, memory cell is. But if that's not the case, so if either your blue number or your red number is odd, and the number you keep in memory is bigger than 10, please raise your hand. So those are the people who are situated at places in this image where something important is happening. I mean, who is the eye? Who was the eye of the person there? Who was the eye of the person? That's at 10 and 10, there. What are the values around you? Yeah, so probably many of the values around you are bigger than 10, because something is happening in all directions. But if you're here, then, well, the differences were zero. If you're here, then, well, this was 3 and 4. I mean, so we didn't notice that. If you're here, then something happens. But so there are many places, some places where something happens, but most places not. That's what happens in a wavelet transform. We change the information to a shape where we can go back to the original. We haven't lost any information, but we have many fewer important numbers. So we have distilled out the marrow of what was going on. Okay. Wavelet decomposition does that. So here I have a black and white image. Of course, we could only do a few pixels because, well, we're a small room. I mean, when the Museum of Mathematics will have like mega church gatherings, I mean, we can do an image like this. But if I average horizontals and vertically, then I obtain an image that just looks a little bit smaller. Because, well, you had all these 40s that you averaged, they get 40. I mean, so except it becomes smaller because 4 pixels have become 1 pixel. I said average between quotes because I'm going to do, in fact, something that is, in mathematical terms, a higher order operation, meaning I'm not just going to take the average, I'm also going to correct with some of the neighbors and so on, so do it a little bit softer. But I'll come back to that. If I take differences horizontally but averages vertically, this is what I get. The numbers could be positive or negative. We saw that. So I now have a range of minus 255 to 255 that I want to depict. The middle of that is 0, so the middle will have to be middle gray. So 0 stands for middle gray. And I will have all black or all white. So most of the numbers are 0, they have that middle gray. When are numbers large? Well, when I have a sudden transition here vertically. If I go from light to dark, that's a big difference. One row higher, I have the same big difference. When I average them, they give me a big number. The other two arrays have to do with differencing vertically. One's averaging, and one's differencing and differencing. I mean, among you, there are people who had twice an average. There are people who had once an average and a difference. There are other once a difference, once an average, and then twice differences. So that's what happens here too. So here I find big things when I have a vertical transition. And here I have things when I have a kind of checkerboard, an oblique kind of situation in the image. Now, this image is a very large image, so we can do several layers. This, I can again do averages and differences, and let me do that. This information is equivalent to that smaller image I had there. Because just like before with averages and differences, whenever you have an average and a difference of two numbers, I can go back. With my newer, fancier averages, I will be able to do the same again. So this information is the same as what I had in the medium-sized boat image. If I want to go back to the original, I also need this information. But so what I show you here on the right is everything I need in order to go back to the original image without loss. I can do it again on this. And that, together with these extra two layers, gives me. And I can do it again and again. So I have reduced, I've done five of these layers. I've reduced information from this image to what I'm showing here. And see how many of these are middle gray. Also notice that 3/4 of those numbers I got at the very finest scale already. And then I got 3/4 of a 1/4, and 3/4 of another 1/4, and so on. Okay. So let's. What do these numbers mean? Well, as I told you, I can always use the numbers and go back. So I can add the differences back to the averages and so on and go back. Imagine that I did that going back, but I neglected all the differences. That would mean that I would look at what it means, what the meaning is of those numbers in the top left. So let's do that. Reconstruct from only that top left. And then I get the thing here on the right. And that's where you see that I used smarter averages, because if I had just used averages all the time, then this would give me blocks of 32 by 32 wide that would be uniform. That's not what I'm getting. I'm getting things that are kind of smoother. And that's because I did this higher order scheme. But I have a very coarse information. And as I add in, now I'm going to add in details at the coarse level and more. And you see how that builds up the image gradually, adding the detail everywhere. Okay, we'll go revisit that because I'd like to show something that is very important about this. So let's look at two pieces of the image, one in the sky, one in the sail. And I've given them on the left here. And here they are their reconstructions from only the top left before, you know, only the very coarse coefficients. And if I then reconstruct, you see how detail gets filled in. Let's do that again. Let's concentrate for a moment just on the sail. So I'm adding in. And you see, I need, at every level, I need more stuff because more detail is needed. Let's look at the sky. Here, I mean, if I go back, you. Certainly, people at the front should see that something is still happening in the sky. But then if I go at the next level, there's not much happening in the sky at all. And that's because in the sky, there's only some very coarse detail. After I've added that, I can forget about all the rest. I could put those coefficients to zero. It wouldn't make a perceptible difference. That you can use that for compression, because what I'm saying is that in the sky, where all these numbers are very small, I can forget about them. So let's forget all the numbers that are small, except the ones that shine out as large, that I already see as non-middle gray. So let's color those red. Well, if I do that and I reconstruct it only using those numbers, then I get the image on the left. And so let me toggle back and forth, so that you see that the image is not perfect. It's not perfect, but let's look. It's only using 1/30th of the full information. The space in memory I need in order to store this non-perfect image is 1/30th of what I needed before. Before, I needed 8 bit per pixels. 1/30th of 8-bit per pixel is about, well, 30 is about 32, means I have about one bit for 4 pixels. Because 4 pixels would take me 32 before. So one bit for 4 pixels, that's enough to tell you whether a 2x2 square is mostly dark or mostly light. That's all. And that would give you a very terrible image indeed. Yet I get this good image because I've used my one bit per four pixels in a much better way. If I use even more coefficients, also the ones I use in green, I get a perfect image. So that's how image compression works with wavelets. And this is the image compression that is actually used in digital cinema in the States and in Europe. It's used also for ESPN transmissions. The very first time I became aware of that was when we had bought a very nice big high definition television screen. And my husband was watching a soccer game, and I saw that there were artifacts that I knew were wavelet artifacts. I said, they use wavelets. And he said, yes, how do you see that? And he was following the game. I said, look here in the grass. He says, who cares about the grass? Of course, nobody cares about the grass. People care about the sharp edges of the players, which you did see. I mean, which don't, because that's where things happen. And that's where the coefficients stay large, and that's where you keep them. And where the grass, well, is kind of a little bit like we had in the sky, nobody cares. And so you can compress quite well there. OK, so you can use this also. We saw compression. But it's also very nice that we have this localization. Imagine that you're interested in, you know that this is sailboats, and you want this area. I mean, for the sailboat picture, nobody would really care. It's hard to imagine an application where that would be so important. But imagine that you want to call up medical data over a line with a very small channel width, bandwidth. And there's lots of data at the other side. But you don't want it to spend the 10 minutes that this image is going to take to download. You want to tell it, I only need details in this area. Forget about the rest. Well, you can convey that information. It can then color this red in the database and send you only that information to reconstruct. And as you add in the detail, this is what you get. So that is a very nice feature of the wavelet transform, which is indeed why it is successful and used now in these applications for digital image compression. OK, so we have a transform that uses localized building blocks that are adapted to different scales. And you use the fine scale building blocks only where they're needed. Where they're not needed, because there's no detail of that scale happening, you don't care. OK, so let's look at this concept again, slightly differently, and already relating it to paintings. So here we have a painting, again, a grayscale version of a painting by Vincent van Gogh of two clogs. The averaging in both directions that we were doing, if instead of showing it to you smaller, I blew it up again, what it would show is that you had blurred things slightly. I mean, we've lost the fine detail. And so what you can do is you can look at the difference between these two images, which is this, and I've blown it up a little bit here, multiplied by a factor 100 so that you would see it. The difference is indeed the sharpness of the lines, because those edges are a bit blurrier. So let's look at what several scales of this, several levels of this do. Let's look at the little piece of the clog. And we blur it. We blur it again and again. And let's look at the successive differences. And here I am using a color scale showing you the differences. So it's artificial color in order to highlight the differences and also to show which ones are positive and negative. So these are the three differences that I showed to you. Now, one thing is very striking, namely the edge of the clog I find everywhere. A very sharp edge. You blur it slightly. You blur it more. You blur it even more every time you lose something. So every time the difference is going to show up. Edges live at all scales. But there are other areas here, like in that little area that I'm showing you, where something shows up markedly at an intermediate scale, but not so much at the finer or the coarser scale. So there are features and images that show up at certain intermediate scales and then die out again. So what you can do is you can look at an image of a painting and look at, in these different angles, what are the scales at which details or features live predominantly. I mean, at the finest scales, at the intermediate scales, and so on. So you can make a little statistic like that of these pieces of the painting. And this is what we used in the very first work we did on applying digital image analysis to paintings. And this was something we did with at a workshop. We showed the results of at a workshop in Amsterdam at the Van Gogh Museum. This was a workshop we've called this series now IP4AI, Image Processing for Art Investigation. I mean, the closest I'll ever come to CSI. But and we were asked to whether we could quantify by means of digital image analysis similarities and differences in style. And they had given us a whole collection of paintings by Van Gogh or by artists that Van Gogh admired, like the flower portrait here, for instance, or by a younger disciple of Van Gogh, with whom who he had inspired and with whom he had exchanged paintings. And so at Van Gogh's death, these paintings were found in his collection, his own private collection, and people thought they were his paintings, but in fact they had been painted by this other guy, and that was later documented. Or this, which is a famous forgery of Van Gogh from the 1930s. And so what we did is, for all these paintings, we cut them into, well, we virtually cut them into little pieces. And then for each of the pieces, we used that statistics, and then we looked at the collection of the statistics for the pieces for one painting and for the collection for another painting and so on. And we compared those using machine learning techniques. And that enabled us to say, well, this is quite similar to that, this is more dissimilar, and so on. And so we got a distance matrix between all those. And we could then, we made a mobile, a virtual mobile, of these paintings where they were hanging at the distances from each other that we had computed. And you see the ones that are not by Van Gogh are more to the outside. This painting is not close to the center, but it's not as far to the outside as some other paintings that are by Van Gogh. So this did a good job in capturing style, but not in capturing whether something was a copy or an original. Well, a good copy tries to imitate the style, so it might be harder to catch. So, but they had also asked us, could we detect that? And then we remembered that Eric Postma, in early work, had analyzed this forgery and compared it with Van Gogh's, and he said copies have more wavelets in their decomposition. We said, what does that mean, more wavelets? They all have the same number of wavelets. Well, more important wavelets. And remember how I showed you that the fine scale wavelets are 3/4 of all the coefficients. The only way you can have a very large number of fine scale wavelets in one of wavelets in one painting and not in another is if you have many more fine scale wavelets, because that's the bulk of them. So we decided we would look at the fine scales. And our theory is, and this is what we, I'll come back to that when you copy a painting, when you paint in a style that's not your own, then you try to lay the brush strokes down in a more deliberate way, a more painstaking way, which makes you less fluid. And these slight hesitations, microscopic really, which you don't really see with the naked eye, are what gives you this very, very fine scale wavelets. And so that's why you have so much more fine scale going on. And indeed, that's what Eric Postma had been able to detect. And this is something that you can still find on internet. If you Google painting authentication Nova van Gogh. Then you'll come out on this little snippet of a Nova program, about 13 minutes, that was filmed about then, where the people from Nova had given the three image teams that worked on this workshop the challenge that they would give them a week before the workshop, six scans of Van Gogh paintings. Five would be authentic and one would be a copy, a new copy that they had commissioned themselves from an expert art copier, and would we be able to recognize it? So we were game, and indeed, by looking at the finest scales, we did find that this particular painting was the copy, and that was indeed the case. And the Van Gogh Museum said, well, that was very nice, television and so on, but let's be a little bit scholarly about this, please. So for the next workshop, they said, let's do a much more controlled experiment. We have, they said, in our collection, a copy of a Van Gogh painting that we value, but for completely different reasons. We value it because it was a copy made very soon after his death of a painting, a portrait of little girls, and little girls had some pink in their dresses. And the copy shows that pink. The original by Van Gogh is completely white. I mean, the dress, the pink is gone. It's gone because Van Gogh used a vermilion that was cheaper, very bright, but cheaper and not as stable. And where he used masses of it, we have the color, but where he used a little bit of it, it's gone. And so they value this painting because it gave them a good impression of the original coloring. But it was a copy, and we could use it for our theory. And so they said, we'll include it with the new 21 paintings for which you will give you scans. Fine. So we say, very cocky, of course we. We look at 21 new paintings, and we find that all of them are, according to our criterion of, is this more hesitant? Has this so many fine scale coefficients that we would think it is a copy? All of them feature have that feature. And we knew that some of them were absolutely authentic without any doubt. So we knew something was wrong. So we do the test again, a different computation, different, always the same. So we kind of discreetly inquire with one of the other teams. So we have this problem. And I said, you too? So why was this the case? Well, we had neglected to really think through how these scans were provided to us. Of course, we knew that they didn't just unhook the painting and then slam it on a scanner and scan it. I mean, you don't really do that with a Van Gogh. What was done was that photographs were taken in between. I mean, actually, museums always have, of any piece in their collection, have large-scale positive slides in ektachrome, which they keep, which are made by professionals, and which they keep in their collection. They do it in ektachrome because that gives them the best color viability. And when somebody wants a reproduction for a book or a publication or so on, they get that photograph to use for the making the book, and they pay the fee that the museum, the serious fee that the museum gets for that purpose. And okay, right now is the generation where people are starting to do this digitally. But until recently, this was always done in ektachrome and analog on these positive slides. Typically, these had to be remade every 15 years or so because ektachrome is not a stable film. I mean, so it deteriorates. So every 15 years would be a new campaign. Okay, so these were the slides that had been scanned in Postma's lab. And data set we got had been on an older scanner. He'd bought a new scanner. And so he scanned them with greater detail. And so that's why they were sharper. So that problem was solved. But it made us realize that we should have factored in that acquisition step in evaluating, since we were looking at sharpness of these scans. And there's a lot of work that we could use that was already known, because all these point-and-shoot cameras that people have, digital things, like in your cell phones, have a lot of nice software in them that tries to correct for blur. I mean, it tries to first detect that there's blur and then correct for it. So that detecting of blur, how could they do that? Well, it turns out that the blur acts differently on edges and corners and T-junctions and so on. And so you can estimate from a picture how blurred it was. And we did that then for our data set. We did that for everything in the data set, not only these six. We actually found interesting stuff. We found, for instance, that the photographer used by the museum in Amsterdam was slightly less sharp than the one used by the Kolhe-Müller Museum. He was slightly sharper. I mean, it was all beyond what they normally would need, so it didn't make a difference to their application. So we then designed a blur index, and zero was not blurred at all. One was the very worst that we saw in the data set, and these were the numbers we got for the Nova 6. So we may well have, in our detection, been helped by the fact that the photograph, which had been taken 3 weeks before, of the Van Gogh, the new Van Gogh, the imitation Van Gogh, was just much sharper. So here I am on internet forever, giving a high five to my student about this great result we obtained, and maybe it was all a fake. So I've been confessing it extensively since then. Here's actually what I wanted to show. You see, this is a very, very, very enlarged brushstroke, not by Van Gogh, but another painting that we'll encounter again, in which you see, individual strokes of the individual hairs in the brush, you can see. And so you see that in the detail, you kind of see the kind of, this is a copy, a little wobbliness, yes, no, yes, no, yes, and so on, that you wouldn't see in the original. So that's what we believe we see. Anyway, we had asked Charlotte Caspers, who was the artist who made the copy for the Nova, and we'll encounter her again later, to paint for us pairs of small paintings. So let me tell you about Charlotte. So the reason they had contacted her is that she's an art conservator, but she's especially trained in copying artists. And she doesn't work in conservation. She usually works on what she calls reconstruction projects. So museums or educational purposes or others or for study purposes like sometimes to have fragments of a painting reconstructed now with materials that are as much as possible traditional materials so that they can see intermediate stages, so that they can have a study object that can be used for a number of purposes. Here you see her painting a fragment of the altarpiece in Ghent, which is a very famous altarpiece, a very influential painting in its time in the 14th century by Jan van Eyck. And she was asked to paint, to make that same painting three times, but stop it at different intermediate stages. And that is now exhibited together with the painting in Ghent. Here you see the same idea, but for a museum in Rotterdam, where she stopped a quarter of an inch shorter every time at every layer of preparation. So she has all these layers of preparation on the wood, and then all these layers of gesso, and then she's starting with a drawing and so on. She's bolus, several layers of bolus, gilding, polishing, and so on. She doesn't start painting until here. I mean, so that many layers. So Charlotte has this special training in she knows all the materials, and she can copy. She have the original next to it, copy the brush strokes, and she has a very steady hand, and she knows all these different techniques of different periods. Here you see her. We had commissioned her to come and paint a couple of small paintings make copies of her own paintings. The reason was that this would give us a test set in which we controlled all the variables. It was same lighting conditions, same artist, and so on. The only difference was it a freehand painting or was she copying? Copying with keeping her hand very steady on this long brush that she holds, and so on. And an original would take her between 20 and 25 minutes. a copy would typically take 30 to 45 minutes. So they would take longer. So that was evidence that there was this different process. So I have this whole collection of oil sketches of Tchotchkes, that because way a lot of she was staying in our house. Actually, if you can see here, she this was a studio we made in the basement. This was the drum set of my son, and so she found these Tchotchkes and made little studies of them. And they are in different materials with different styles. This is on very coarse canvas. This is in the style of the Flemish primitives, even though it's a subject that they might not have painted. This is that little dragon of which we saw a very small brushstroke, this little bit here, blown up earlier when I was showing you the wobble on a copy. And what we found is that indeed, with this data set, we can distinguish copies from originals. The data set has been made publicly available, and people can download it from our webpage at Duke. We have, a couple of years ago, Charlotte came to North Carolina for 2 months, and working on a project with which I, but that will come up in a few minutes. And she then painted, because the other ones were oil sketches, they were things that were painted in 20 minutes, one layer, and that's done. These are true paintings in that they are several layers which are left to dry and then new layers painted on top of that. So these are really more serious paintings, a study of birds of North Carolina. And for this pair, we know which is the original, which is the copy. For all the others, it's known as well. Charlotte has marked them and has put the information under seal with the chair of the art department at Duke. And we are developing tools in order to decide on the others. And I think next summer is when we will say that we have great confidence on deciding which. And then we will have a public event where this gets opened and so on. Because when you work with art historians, I mean, you can say, well, in machine learning, people do this. And everybody trusts that you use only some for tests and only some for training. Makes not the same impression at all than if you're truly blind. Just okay. The interesting thing that has happened with this work that we're doing is that whenever I've given a talk about this, and there are art historians or art conservators in the audience, there's somebody who will come up to me and say, "This was very interesting, but if you can do this, maybe you can help us with that." And that has often been really, really interesting. And so these have given over and over again, research projects on which I have had students and postdocs work together and collaborated with them. And so they're bona fide tough problems that cannot be solved with off-the-shelf technology. And so we get interesting science out of them. But then it leads to interesting results that is of interest to art historians. So this was the first one of this type. This is a painting by Vincent van Gogh. It's a study of blooming grass. And he painted it in his Paris period. It had been known for a long time that there's something underneath this painting. In fact, about 30% of Van Gogh's paintings have another painting underneath. Because often when he made a study and he felt he had learned what he wanted to learn out of the study, because canvas is expensive and he was poor, he would just put a new primer layer of primer over and use it again to paint something else. So there's something else, and the x-ray shows that underneath, if you turn it on its side, is, you see here, the ghost of a portrait. And so people thought that this was one of many portraits he had painted when he was still in the Netherlands, living with his parents prior to joining Theo van Gogh in Paris. And at the time that he was experimenting with a very dark palette, and he wanted to show, wanted to see how well he could render color with this very dark palette. The only light color he had on his palette was a Naples yellow. All the other colors were very dark. And there's the whole correspondence of Theo and Vincent van Gogh has been preserved. And there's a letter from Vincent to Theo that says, "I'm sending you here a painting that I recently made and in which I really feel that I succeeded very well with this rendering color with a very dark palette." And that painting has never been found. Now, so it's not, it was very reasonable to suppose that the painting was in fact the one that was under the blooming grass. Because once in Paris, Van Gogh would have met the Impressionists, would have changed his style completely, and he would no longer have attached such value to that particular painting. But that's why art historians were interested. So Joris Dick and Koen Janssen pioneered a method about 10 years ago of X-ray fluorescence. There, Joris Dick is both an art historian and a materials scientist. And so Koen Janssen works on uses X-ray fluorescence almost exclusively in chemistry and material science. And so X-ray fluorescence is a method by which you bombard a small area with very high energy X-rays. They ionize everything, things fall back, and if they fall back by fluorescing, meaning falling back in two layers, then the energy of the second photon that is sent out when the ionization is undone, is characteristic for the atom that you're looking at, because it's the difference between two energy levels of that atom. So you bombard, you look at all the spectrum that you get out, and then you find the spectral lines of different elements. And that way you know which elements are present where. You do it here and here and here. And so they did that with this Van Gogh painting. And with spectacular results. I mean, it really was made a big splash. You see here, it made the cover of the Journal of Analytical Chemistry. This is one of the raw data they got. This is what they got for antimony, which was antimony is an atom that in the compound of Naples yellow that Van Gogh was using. And here is one for arsine. Which is represented in the vermilion, and so you see indeed the red comes out very, very nicely. Here is, I think this was mercury, and it doesn't show anything from the bottom painting, it's mostly a top painting. Okay, so this cover was actually artfully put together. What they had done is, with the different color information, they had some red, they had some yellow, they had colorized the image. And so this was the hidden portrait underneath. And indeed, you did see much more than you could see earlier than this ghost-like portrait. But Koen Janssen said, look, we are only material scientists with image processing. You can probably do much more. And he'd given us the raw data to see whether we could do more. And indeed, There are a number of problems with the data. One problem was, which he pointed out to us, I mean, and he had kind of manually tried to change it a little bit, but I mean, he knew it was more prevalent. You see this kind of zigzag structure here. That's, okay, so how had they done this X-ray fluorescence? By now, because it's a good method, people have built apparatuses that they take to museums to do this, but at that time, a high-energy X-ray beam is not something that you just have in your pocket. I mean, it's an expensive thing. And so they had found money and gotten the authorization to take this painting, because it's, after all, only a study. I mean, it's not one of the famous Van Goghs, to a hospital in Amsterdam, a teaching hospital where they had a high-energy X-ray beam that was used to make radioactive compounds that are used for imaging of tumors and whenever you have one of these machines, because it's not the beam is not used full time for the radioactive element fabrication, when it's not used for that, they would divert it in a different direction. It could be used by physicists for their experiments, which would help pay for the maintenance of this expensive machine. And so they had gotten some hours on this machine, by means of which they would X-ray fluoresce this painting. And so it would be done pixel by pixel, because it had to be done in very little spots, because otherwise, if you did too much, first of all, they didn't have the beam for it, but second, it would have heated up the painting too much. You needed to do it a little bit by a little bit at a time, so that a little bit of heat could always disperse easily. And of course, the beam, you don't move the beam like that. You switch it to a different thing, but then you keep the beam fixed. So what moved was the painting, in order to get a different pixel every time. It was a very narrow beam. And that sled had to stop whenever the beam went back to its real job. And there was a problem in the synchrony of that program. And so that's why the scanning went in zigzag. And because there was a synchrony problem, it was not scanning at the place where it thought it was scanning. And so that's why you have this zigzag artifacts. But they are in fact happening all over the place. Here they're very visible, but they're happening in other places as well. And so the first thing we had to do was to undo to restore the image for those. And what we did is we said, well, let's suppose that you have up 10 breaks per line. We did a variational argument in order to make things to adjust it so that there would be the fewest possible jumps. I mean, there were jumps in some places. We had these big black blotches because there were places where the top painting had too much paint with Van Gogh's new impasto method, and x-rays hadn't gone through, so we had no data. So that's why you had black blotches. But you certainly didn't have naturally these kind of zigzag things. So we restored with a variational principle that. That's the first thing we did. So we went from what you have here on the left to what is on the right. Then the next thing we did was in painting. In painting. Well, in painting is done by art conservators on real paintings that have had paint losses in museums. In order. And how can they do it? Well, these are brush strokes. You see what the brush stroke was just before and just after, and so you can reconstruct in between. And what they do with their brushes, we can do computationally. And Photoshop does it too. Photoshop does it based on the algorithm developed by Guillermo Sapiro, which he calls impainting, because it was inspired. It was computational, but inspired by what art conservators do in a museum, which they call impainting. So we put the mask down. We found the dark blotches. We put the mask down, and then we impainted. There were these long stretches that came from the top painting. We found masks for those, and we impainted. And then there was still a problem around the eye, and we didn't know what to do with that. But then the art conservator says, oh, use the other eye. We do that all the time. And it makes sense. I mean, you use the technique that the painter has for painting an eye because he's using the same technique for the other eye. It's not so cheating as you think. Okay, so, and you see how very gracefully this impainting has worked. So this was what they had originally with the yellow and the red. But you can sense some colors are missing. Well, we had no information. With just yellow and red, you don't have enough information to fill in the whole color thing. So what we did is we looked at the other paintings by Van Gogh in the same period. This is one that has the least contrast of all of them. This is one that has the most contrast of all of them. And they look very, very different. Notice that in both cases, there are large, large parts that are completely dark. So you cannot hope to have any information about them. But we were interested in the lighter parts on the face. Okay, first we looked at, we morphed them to the face that we had. And then we looked at luminescence, which was very different for both of them because one is much brighter than the other. And what remained was the color. Once you have luminescence away, color has only two components anymore then. Color has what color am I looking at? Is it yellow? Is it orange? Is it, and so on. And how saturated is it? How close to white? I mean, very saturated means no white at all. Unsaturated means very pastel-y. Okay, so it turns out, I don't know whether this will come over as well on the screen as it does on my computer. But remember, you should forget all these dark parts because, I mean, they look purple in one and different in the other, but they don't mean anything because there's no information there. In the other parts, the saturation was different, but the colors were actually quite similar. So it meant that, unbeknownst to Van Gogh, there was a pattern, a similarity in his paintings, even if they were very different in real aspect, that we could then exploit in order to reconstruct based on what we already had on what we call the lady 6 millimeters under to reconstruct. And so this is what we got. So the contrast, I mean, so this is what we were given. Well, and this is what we got. And so Joris Dick was very, very happy he spoke to us. Oh my God, it's 3 times past 8. just a few words about a more recent project. This is a project now that I'm at Duke. I'm working with the Museum of North Carolina Museum of Art. And this is a project on an altarpiece that of which panels are scattered all over the US. Three of them are in the North Carolina Museum of Art collection, but others are in Portland or in Chicago or here in New York. One of them is missing, and they wanted to bring them together. Now, the other museum said, why should we do that? You have a missing panel anyway. But Bill Brown, hearing about Charlotte Gaspers, commissioned her to actually reconstruct that missing panel. Now, reconstruct a panel you don't have to copy. How can you do that? Well, you cannot, of course. But what you can do is you can design something that would not have surprised the original viewers in the 14th century if it had been in that place. You can design something with the subject of that missing panel was known, because these stories are very, these hagiographies of saint, this is a saint of St. John the Evangelist, are very, very characteristic, very codified, so they knew what scene was missing. So you had to draw a scene, design a scene in the same style as the others, and if you look back at the others, you see the style is quite uniform. You have St. John on one side, and he's always doing this or that or that, so you can put him in that position. And he's baptizing the notable who finally is convinced to become a Christian. So you can design something like that, and you can then paint it with the materials of that period. And so that's what Charlotte did. And then in order to paint brush strokes for different parts of the ropes and so on, she would indeed copy from the paintings that she had, because. Okay, so here you see her putting bolus down, gilding, polishing the gold, punching, and here's a detail of the finished painting. It's really exquisite. I mean, you see the punches in the gilding and so on. It's so bright, it's so new. The whole process was also documented. I mean, the making of a painting with these old traditional styles. And so the exhibit is going to take place this fall in North Carolina in the museum in Raleigh. And the other museums have agreed to lend their panels. And here you see a mock-up of the completed altarpiece. It's only when the preparation were being made for the exhibit that they realized they were going to have a problem. Yes, this new panel is going to give such a fantastic impression to visitors of how beautiful and shiny and bright this was when it was in the 14th century, when it was new. But the real will look so dull in comparison. I mean, nobody's going to have eyes for them. I mean, that was not a goal. I mean, after all, this new one is not the real thing. So what's the mathematics can solve this problem. What we're going to do is, in the exhibit, the new panel will have its own space with a documentary that people can see in an alcove about how it was made, with an exposition of the materials, the punches and so on that were used. And at the unified altarpiece, instead of the new one, we'll have a virtually aged one, a print of a virtually aged one. We'll virtually age it, and then we'll print it out, and it will be obvious that it's not as authentic as the others. And for that, we had to find how to look it cracked, do pigment fading and so on. And yes, we can do all that. And then once we can do that, we can also virtually rejuvenate the older ones. I mean, and so on a separate wall, there will be an impression given, projection of how these panels would have looked new. And they will look bright and shiny and so on. And we'll have, I mean, the gold doesn't do well on photographs, but I mean, so we'll have a little movie showing them rotate slightly. And there will be explanation of all the math that went into that. So there will be an exhibit that has the art and the math both in it. Now, can we do that? Yes, we can do all that. Because in fact, we've done something similar, finding cracks and impainting them on another painting. And that's the very last thing I will talk about. The same altarpiece I was mentioning earlier. When you close it, this is what it looks like. And there is a book in the Annunciation piece, the annotation panel, and if you enlarge it, this is what it looks like. So this is, of course, it's not a book, it's a painting of a book. And this, what I'm showing here is about this high in the painting. And people had been wondering, had been trying to read it. And some people said, and it was not really feasible, because it was hard to distinguish the letters. You see, the thing is very cracked, and the cracks are about the same color as the letters, and many of them are in the same direction. And it's just, our brain is not good at thinking these cracks away. We're just not good at that. And so they had been able to read two or three words, divisione dei, about the division of God. But they said, well, that's probably all that he really painted. For the rest, he painted something that looks like letters. And I must say that even a book that completely in a museum that is not cracked at all in these letters, I cannot read. But specialists, of course, can. But the specialists couldn't read this, and they were saying, well, it's only a painting. And we had taken it as a challenge to, first of all, find an automatic way of finding these cracks, which was harder than I thought. I might not have promised that we could do it if I had known how hard, but we did succeed. And once we had found the cracks, we could do in painting. And that's what we've done here. And once we had it in painted, we said, well, that was all a lot of work for nothing, because we can't read anything more than before. But the experts could. The experts could. They could say, oh, look, this is really a W, not a piece of an A. This is, look. And so they have now identified 12 groups of words which make it possible to unambiguously identify the text that was shown here, which is a text by Thomas of Aquinas on the Annunciation. And so it's mind-boggling to them, because it means a whole lot about the painting and so on. And we were very pleased, of course, that our work had not been for naught. But so yes, we can fill in cracks. Yes, we can in-paint. Yes, it can be useful. So we can do this for the Gissi. The Gissi has led to other things as well, which I have no more time to talk about, but which you can learn about if you come to the exhibit in North Carolina in the fall. Thank you.
Well, although Professor Daubechies has no more time to talk, she does have the time to answer a few questions. If you have a question, raise your hand. I will bring the microphone over to you. You will stand up and ask the question, and then we'll see what she has to say. So, who would like to start? I see one back here.
Will the virtual museums of the future be filled with mathematically corrected images of everything, restoring things to how they appeared supposedly at the time they were created?
Well, I don't know. They might well be. Actually, already now that the art conservators have seen what we can do, they have been wondering about whether this might eventually lead to, for some art pieces, the decision to not start retouching it, but just stabilize it completely and do the other work virtually. I mean, I think that for certain works might well be something that, on the other hand, people do have a more visceral connection to the physical object. So it's a difficult issue, and it's one on which I feel they are the experts and they should make the decisions. I mean, I'm very happy to provide the tools, and I'm especially happy that getting to these tools turns out to be challenging, non-standard problems for us, and so it is. Gives very interesting research problems for undergrads, graduate students, and postdocs, with much more fun results. It's so much more fun to study Van Eyck in your images than to study a photograph of red peppers, which is one of the standards in image processing.
Any other questions?
How well do these techniques apply to restoring music? So like very early recordings that were full of static and things, can you apply the same sort of thing to music?
Okay, so the answer is yes and no. First of all, there's a lot of work that has been done on old recordings, some of it using wavelets and some of it not. It typically does not use image processing, although I'll come back to that. So for instance, people have, there are old records that were on wax cylinders. there is an old cylinder made by Edison. I think of Brahms directing an orchestra. I mean, which cylinder has? I mean, not only is it old and so on, but it was partly melted in a fire. I mean, so you can imagine this. The kind of, not much has been recovered from that. But on the other hand, there is a recent technique by somebody in Stanford, and his name escapes me right now, and I'm very sorry about that, who is a physicist who has started to apply imaging to these very old recordings, where he images with great detail and also with depth imaging these discs, and then uses a 3D model to replay them virtually and remove cracks. So yes, a lot of but it's they're of necessity different techniques than the ones I've used. But they do require that same kind of taking things apart into scales and clean out and identify things separately. And yeah.
I have another one right here.
Yeah, I'm thinking of medical applications. Could these methods be used to distinguish one kind of tissue from another, healthy versus diseased, for example?
Yes, and in fact, they are. I mean, there have been applications of these imaging, of these image analysis techniques to medical applications well before we applied them to art. And I'm working on some of those too. I mean, I have other projects than the art projects, but which. It's too long to get into now, but yeah, absolutely. And together with machine learning, they are starting to become very effective.
If we know in terms of artistic deterioration of art over a period of time, given the chemicals or the makeup of the artwork, and we know how it's going to deteriorate, we can predict somewhat. Is it possible for an artist, for instance, to add additional chemicals to the artwork in the knowledge that 10 years from now, for example, it will have deteriorated to this point, but if I add this component to it, 10 years from now, it'll look the way I meant it to look?
Ah, so. First of all, I'm completely out of my depth in this, but I can tell you the little bit I know that I think already different artists have very different techniques and use different materials with very which gives to a wide range of aging effects. The altarpiece of Ghent. Is actually, maybe we can go back to it, to the full thing. Here, the panel that's shaded on the bottom left is shaded because it is missing. Two panels were stolen at some point before the Second World War, and only one of them was recovered. The other one has never been recovered. So what is exhibited is a copy that was painted by a gifted painter, Verweken, in the 1930s. But he didn't use traditional materials. He used the materials of his time. And that painting is already now in much worse condition. So this is from the 1930s than the rest of the painting, which is from the 1430s. Mm. So difference of material makes a big, big difference. Now, what Van Eyck did is use materials that have been extremely stable over time, and which I think is the best. I mean, plus I don't know that he ever thought that his work would live for as long as it has. I mean, In his case, the cathedral for which it was painted is still standing, but many of the other paintings, for instance, the Gissi altarpiece, which is of course much smaller and much less famous, much less prestigious, is from a church that no longer exists. I mean, it was taken out of the church before the church was demolished. I don't know. I mean, I expect that in some cases artists may do that already a little bit, knowing that a year from the making things will have cured. I mean, they then call it curing, not, I mean, will have cured to the stable stage. But it would be hard to see how they could do it hundreds of years in advance, or whether it would be worth it. But
anyone else? Oh, we're right here.
Say if a student who was, say, middle school or high school age who wanted to go into image processing thought this was super cool, what would you recommend for them to start with, like, learning?
Programming. I mean, for any of these, you need to know how to program. I mean, you need to be, you need to be comfortable with the idea that you can transfer things from one data format to another data format and compute things with it and then maybe do something else with it and so on. So I think that's very important. I mean, it needs to be a language for you. I mean, a nest in which you feel comfortable. And then anything that helps develop analytical thinking. I mean, because again, this requires, now some of the mathematics that's in here is kind of too advanced for somebody in middle school, but analytical thinking and programming would give a fantastic preparation.
Okay, on that note, please join me in thanking the speaker one more time.